The previous chapter had Elizabeth's letter filled with light and joy, the image of Justine Moritz in it, of romance and of sweet young William, who's, again, remember, the image of Victor's youth, of his childlike outlook towards the world. Well, here we get a second letter, which is from his father, and it is of a very different tone. This one actually proclaims point blank that his brother is dead. William is dead. That sweet child whose smiles delighted and warmed my heart, who was so gentle yet so gay. Victor, he is murdered. I will not attempt to console you, but will simply relate the circumstances of the transaction. He finds out that his younger brother has been murdered, has been killed. And in the letter, he also finds out that there was some strange circumstance with the death of his brother. Mainly that Elizabeth has a very odd reaction to finding out that the young boy is dead. It says it's as though she takes responsibility immediately for his death. Elizabeth was very earnest to see the corpse. At first I attempted to prevent her, but she persisted in entering the room where it lay, hastily examined the neck of the victim, and clasping her hands exclaimed, "Oh God, I have murdered my darling infant." It's a very strange reaction for her to have. But it's as though she immediately has a concept of somehow she herself has done this, and so she takes on this guilt. This is a similar thing to what Victor does later on. But she has reason, to some degree, for feeling this way, because as it says in the letter, there's a circumstance that she is involved in that she thinks caused his death. She told me that same evening William had teased her to let him wear a very valuable miniature that she possessed of your mother. This picture is gone and was doubtless a temptation which urged the murderer to the deed. We have no trace of him at present, although our exertions to discover him are unremitted, but they will not restore my beloved William. So Elizabeth allowed William to wear a miniature, a small painting or portrait of her mother, of their mother, of Victor's mother. And he was wearing that picture. And when he comes back dead, he's not wearing that anymore. And Elizabeth thinks that's the cause of his being murdered. And so she takes on herself the guilt of having allowed him to wear this, which she thinks then is the cause of his death. It's a strange device, because I think that it would be unusual for somebody to immediately say, "Oh, is the necklace there? Oh, it's not. That must be why he's killed. I killed him." It's a strange reaction. But it is a reaction which then allows us to have the device of the miniature or the locket that is the mother of Victor, notice. So again, that image of Victor's mother as the cause of death here, the relationship to his mother is brought up again in a similar way to why he created the monster, in order to compensate for his mother's death originally. It's an odd coincidence. Well, Victor returns home because of the murder of his brother, and he travels by coach back to his town, to Geneva. And when he gets there, it turns out that the gates are locked. And so he says, I immediately resolved to go and visit the place where my brother was murdered. It was completely dark when I arrived in the environs of Geneva. The gates of the town were already shut. The sky was serene, and as I was unable to rest, I resolved to visit the spot where my poor William had been murdered. As I could not pass through the town, I was obliged to cross the lake in a boat to arrive in Plain Palais. He resolves to go and visit the spot where William was murdered, which is strange, because how does he know where that is? Certainly the area of Plain Palais is known to him, but the spot where William was murdered, the exact spot, that was not in the letter sent to him. And so when he goes to arrive at that spot, it seems odd how he could know where William was murdered. How could he know? One way or the other, he goes to visit where William is murdered, and he crosses over the water of Lake Geneva in a boat to get to the place. And notice again, water imagery here. Crossing over in a boat imagery again here. This is in some ways prophetic. Mary Shelley has throughout the story the image of being on a lake, water imagery, the rain coming down, the later on the glacier. All these are water images. And on the one hand, this is prophetic because later Percy Shelley dies in a boating accident, which I think is strange that she would have put it in this novel. And then later her husband dies in a boating accident. But I think more to the point is that she is using that natural imagery of water as an element for Victor's subconscious. Water is a protean element that is unformed matter, or represents the subconscious world, the world of dreams and of sleep. And Victor finds frequently that he is crossing water, or he finds peace on the water, or, and in solitude and alone. Notice that at the very beginning, Robert Walton is also trapped in the water of the ice that opens up the story here in the Arctic. So there, the water is solidified; it's made solid, which, as a spiritual state, is a very bad thing, because if we've got that whole world of the subconscious in a frozen, solidified way, it's as though we're in a hell state almost. Dante Alighieri, at the very bottom of hell, for instance, puts a frozen lake. He doesn't put fire and brimstone, he puts ice, frozen lake with all the sinners in ice. And Mary Shelley was very aware of that work by Dante. And so in some ways, I think she is creating a similar image here with the use of water imagery. He crosses over the lake, and there's a storm coming up over Mont Blanc. And so we've got the mountain of Mont Blanc in the distance with this storm coming up, and the water imagery itself. And notice the image of the mountain too. The mountain, Mont Blanc, is this cold, remote, inanimate matter, big lump of rock. Beautiful, it's true, but nevertheless, it is an inanimate piece of the earth. Shelley himself, Percy Shelley himself, writes this very long poem about Mont Blanc, where he uses it as an image of the mind, and the water flowing out of Mont Blanc is like the imagination flowing out of the mind. And Shelley asks the question, Percy Shelley asks the question, of whether or not the flow of water from Mont Blanc is any different from the flow of imagination from a human person. Are we ourselves simply inanimate matter that is functioning like a machine within a machine? So here we've got Mont Blanc in the distance, we've got the lake, we've got the storm coming up with all the electricity and that image of fire that electricity represents. And it's at this point, at night, that he sees the creature at William's murder site. I perceived in the gloom a figure which stole from behind a clump of trees near me. I stood fixed, gazing intently. I could not be mistaken. A flash of lightning illuminated the object and discovered its shape plainly to me, its gigantic stature, and the deformity of its aspect, more hideous than belongs to humanity, instantly informed me that it was the wretch, the filthy diamond to whom I had given life. What did he there? Could he be, I shuddered at the conception, the murderer of my brother? No sooner did that idea cross my imagination than I became convinced of its truth. My teeth chattered, and I was forced to lean against a tree for support. The figure passed me quickly, and I lost it in the gloom. So he sees the creature there at the site of William's murder, and immediately jumps to the conclusion that this is the murderer of his brother. This thing must have murdered his brother. Why does he see the creature at the moment of trauma and at the moment of sorrow at William's murder site? Why there? And why does he see the creature with all that natural imagery, so the water, the storm, the lightning, the mountain? Those same elements that were there when the creature was first created are here when the creature appears again at the site of William's murder. And why, too, does the creature then pass by him, he says, very closely by him, says nothing to him, there's no exchange between them, but it passes by him, and he has no reaction but to lean against a tree. Immediately notice, too, that the creature bounds up the mountainside. So it's very quickly several miles away from him, bounding up the mountain, which would be impossible if the creature were a real being, or if the creature were a physical being within the story. If it's a figment of his imagination, though, then it is possible that Victor is seeing this demon bound up the mountainside after seeing it again at the site of William's murder place. If the creature is a manifestation of Victor's vision of the world as a machine within a machine, all this makes a lot more sense. We need to begin to see it perhaps as that, to hold in our minds the fact or the possibility that the creature is not actually a reality, that the creature is actually a figment of this diseased imagination that sees the world as dark, claustrophobic, and a machine within a machine.